Hi again. I read through these questions. I think all of us received this, I assume, right? And what I decided was I broke it down into like roughly four or five categories. And so I'll write them down. I'm thinking the way we want to do it is not to make it too formal. So I think people should raise their hands and speak up and make comments. So the main thing that I got out of reading this was, I think that driving access, if you will, is policy, right? So, you know, one way to think about what this group should do is to consider what are the kind of policy level, decisions or statements or recommendations that we may want to make regarding various topics, okay? So just based on these questions, and probably, you know, they are fairly comprehensive, I saw there were five different types of topics, and I'm going to write them down here. And if you feel there are other topics that I overlooked, you can add them. Right. So the first one I saw was about policies regarding assessments and certifications. I think the first question basically, asks, should we require that some percent of the credits are done through whatever. So broadly, we can ask the question, what is our recommendations regarding policies about certifications and assessments with respect to online education? So everything we're talking about obviously is with respect to online education. So one dimension seemed to be certifications in assessments. The other one, which is really what technology should be used. And here there are questions like recommendations, standards, and how prescriptive should the government be? Should it specifically suggest universities, colleges should use certain things or ascribe to certain standards, or whatever else related to technology and type of platforms that may be used. The third topic I saw was related to open source. There are quite a few comments on the questionnaire. What is our position? Do we want to insist that everything that is used for online education by the entire community should be in open source, or specific things should or not, whatever, right? Then there is the question about content rights related to contents and technologies. And when I say content, I mean things like lecture content, labs, and technologies. I mean platforms that allow you to create lectures or because technology helps you. Think of them as tools. As the content is a thing that you create using the tools. And the last topic I saw was how much do we want to push NME ICT projects and outputs. So some of the things that we heard today, for example, that was funded by NME ICT. So they are developing a bunch of tools, solutions. How much do we want to have policy statements regarding pushing them, meaning making them available, recommending, and things like that. Okay. So, out of these 14 questions, I was able to come up with these broad five topics. And I was thinking that, at the end of the day, if we as a group come up with a set of policy, statements that we believe are important to be made on each of these topics, that would probably be a useful naturally they are subject to further discussion and debate, but that would be the output of this particular group for tomorrow. So does this, is everyone comfortable with this approach in the first place, or am I missing something by looking at it this way? So please feel,
I think just do one more column over, just free policy.
No policy.
Without being limited to
For general, okay.
Just to be general.
Yeah, that's fine. Good. Miscellaneous, general, whatever.
Yeah.
That's good. Yeah. I mean, I think whoever speaks at least the first time, you know, if you can introduce yourself, say your name and where you're from, so later on.
I am H.V. Kincha from Bangalore Indian Institute of Science.
So this okay? I think if no one objects to it, I assume everybody is comfortable with it. If you think,
Collaborations and joint programs.
And on policy related to that, can you elaborate what you're thinking?
Whether we should have the joint programs with the good universities, reputed universities. One that is a university that is who is not doing good, okay, must be having the joint MTech or PhD programs for the universities which are really doing good.
Okay. But this is specifically the context of technology use.
The collaborations is one particular aspect which okay. Again,
actually, about the PhD program.
Sorry, one second.
Yeah, okay. Sorry? Sorry, about 12, we have the PhD program. So this may be applicable, collaborate with the industry leading to the PhD program.
Okay, so now I feel nervous with both power. there must be other groups that are better for you. Leading these questions, these are the topics, you know, that we, general being, you know, whatever else is not mentioned. So what would be good is if people who feel specifically that, based on these questions or whatever else you're thinking, that you have an opinion on any one of these topics, I think you should say. Because otherwise, I'll capture whatever is written here in my own thoughts. But rather than filling the board myself, I'd like to invite other people to make comments first. Yes. Please introduce yourself.
My name is Mahesh Venkateshwar, from the National Skill Development Corporation.
Okay.
I lead the innovation piece, but I also work with all our training partners, sector skill councils, other stakeholders in the system, including state government, and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
On the specific assessment and certification piece, NSDC is one of the agencies which is undertaking large-scale skill development activities. And what has been there's a lot of research and best practices that are being looked at in the assessment and certification space.
Mm-hmm.
We've looked at the Swiss model, the filtering model, the Canadian model, and so on and so forth. But we've essentially adopted the international model, Swiss model.
Right.
Now the difference there is, today a training partner, at least in the vocational skills space, is the person who is assessing, the training partner is providing the training, also doing the assessment, and also certifying. For example, you get a certificate from the same person who is actually the training partner.
Mm-hmm.
So in this ecosystem, what you've developed is, we have taken away capacity, which is the training partners on one end. We have actually inserted sector skill councils, which are industry-led bodies, so that the mismatch between the output of the formal education system and what the industry calls employable is kind of bridged. But the assessment is done through a third-party agency. So there are assessment agencies which are empaneled. So we take the sector skill councils on top and empanel training partners on one end, assessment agencies on one end. That's the first differentiation. Second thing is putting
differentiation
in the sense compared to the regular or conventional way of assessing.
Today, let me interrupt for one second because it might still be relevant. What you are speaking about is the general approach to assessment and certification. With respect to the topic here, we probably want to focus on the use of ICT or technology. But what you're saying may still be relevant.
I'm just coming to that, which is, now the second thing is putting the learner at the center of it. Now if I put the learner could be somebody from the automotive sector, could be from the textile sector, could be from rubber plantation, or could be retail services sector. Now each of them has a different profile in terms of training. Some people would require machinery-based assessment systems. Somebody could do it online, somebody could do it differently. So the assessment agencies that we have picked out have the ability to go across. For example, I can build for IT, I can just try somebody on a Java, this thing. But for a tea plantation worker, it's different. For somebody who's doing paddy farming, it's more productivity measures. So what we've done is all the assessment agencies which have come in, they actually have tablet-based things. They also have web-based. But one thing that they all have is the ability to sync up to that central system. So whatever is captured of the learner data, is basically moved all the way up there. And now we are testing the same thing out with, say, mobile phones, in terms of can a person go through assessments over a course of 2 months, and then will that mean that they are actually formally assessed? So I think these are some of the
things. I mean, if I were to, sort of cull something out of what you said, which may be what I think would be relevant to the topic at hand, it would be something like making use of ICT and continuous assessments through, and then the then the gathering of the data over time as sort of a key aspect of any assessment of any sort. Is that roughly what you're trying to say?
Because the data is also in different formats and different this thing. So if we have to create a larger policy, the data has to be
standardized
to begin with, the architecture and so on and so forth. So whatever you build on it.
Right. Okay. It's not so much about, whereas the comment here, for instance, was about saying that, we recommend that some percent of learning that is done through online methods. You're not talking about it. You're simply saying, in the context of assessment, regardless of how the education was imparted, that the assessment be done using, ICT, and then the data be kept and standardized, so to say. Sorry, sir.
I'm a speech teacher from Bangalore. I have two suggestions to make, sir.
Okay.
One is the assessment and certification. Whoever will do that assessment and certification has to be independent of the body which gives the education.
Okay.
This could have to make independent and not plugged into.
So once again, I understand. What I'm trying to separate out here is there may be policy.
It is a policy issue.
No, policy issues related to assessment and certification that are generic and are valid. I don't know, if we start talking about them, we might never finish. So I'm wondering if we want to focus on where you're thinking about, related to technology-oriented education or leveraging technology. You know what I mean? Do you want to go as broad
technology,
as...
Technology-based education.
Right.
That is one thing. The second thought that comes is that the establishment of new forms of certifications, whatever that we may call it, for the customized education systems.
What is that?
A customized education system is the student is the master of what he wants to choose.
Uh-huh.
And he chooses a basket of courses from the available courses, which may not be fitting into the traditional courses that we have at this point of time.
Okay.
He may do 5 courses of electrical, 5 courses of mechanical, 3 courses of biology, and 4 courses of mathematics.
Okay.
And he does this customized, he wants that education.
Customized curriculum,
and he does it. So the certification and the stamping of that certification probably has to be thought of in a different way than the regular certification in this case.
So it actually opens up a question, right? I mean, by the way, anyone can speak to anything. Are we envisioning the evolution of all of this towards customized curriculum for students? I mean, right now, people follow a certain curriculum and syllabus according to the college or university that they that they're with, and that's where it's becoming right. What you're talking about is much more open.
Yes.
Clearly, eventually these kind of technology-enabled solutions will facilitate that. Are we trying to encourage that and therefore prepare for assessing? I'm not sure. Maybe I'll ask Pawan or Pravin if you have an opinion on this.
I have one suggestion to add before Pawan speaks. See, the management ultimately will move towards customized.
Okay.
5 years, 10 years, 15 years, I don't know.
Okay.
But in between this period, we can think of only a certification course-wise or certification and group-wise.
Okay.
Whatever that we can do. And then move towards the system of a customized recognition at the end of whatever you want to call it.
Assessment and certification, we are focusing on online learning.
Yeah, so what he's saying is that online learning introduces the possibility of customized curriculum.
Curriculous.
And what is our approach to assessment and certification? Yeah. Yes, sir.
My name is Vaidya Subramaniam. I am from Shastra University in Punjab. I just have got 2 quick points to make. One is on the, there is some unifying common academic denominator that this common across various syllabi, across all universities, whatever type they are. So as a policy decision, you see, we need to identify such unifying academic curriculum and align that with the NMPICT outputs that have delivered on those common criteria and make sure that that is followed. I mean, it might not, I mean, it should not be taken as an interference in an autonomy of an university, but certainly there are some common
criteria. What's an example of this?
Let's, for example, take a course on thermodynamics.
Okay.
I mean, the experiment that they are going to do from July, like we are going to partner that. Now, suppose such type of mechanisms, and if there is a deliverable output already, then it's better to make sure that every university uses that as a mandate. And then, rendered move, the way in which the facilitator, the faculty is going to use this left to the university. But then the content must be secure, so that the output.
So, but you know, see, I would argue that. See, one of the advantages of you know, these kind of online lectures and so on is that, in fact, there can be a diversity in the, you know, as long as the subject is covered and the various topics in the subject are covered, there can be a large diversity in the way, you know, in the lecture, actual lecture content and so forth, right? So I'm not expecting the blended books model, for instance, to produce one, you know, type of lecture content that everybody will use, and that seems to limit its power. In fact, if anything, you want to create something like a marketplace of, you know, lecture content and users, where a particular, even at the level of a college, a particular professor or lecturer can collect lectures from different sources, add their own.
Yeah, I agree.
So I'm not sure.
But what I'm trying to say is, we have a different structured, you know, type of universities. Universities of one particular type. So let's say we begin to experiment this with, I don't want to use the wrong word, but those that need such types, which is easy to identify and qualify them, who they would potentially be. What I would say is this could be a good, yes, probably no faculty, you know, so many engineering colleges. A good substitute for a bad faculty.
So courses thing, that see, one thing I can see is that, you know, NMEICD or AICD, I don't know who, actually has a recommended set, for example, that can be used by people who...
It's a model curriculum or a model set that can be
used. So I'm, again, what are people think? I'm generally, less it's directed from above, I would think the better it is. Right? So why not let it evolve on the basis of need rather than actually...
And second,
policy,
the second point from a policy perspective is the role of the private institutions in this initiative itself.
Right.
Now, NPTEL phase 1 and when NPTEL phase 2 started, I'm a personal beneficiary. I spoke to the PI and said, there are some good faculty outside the orbit of IIT and IIS, and we should leverage on the expertise of that faculty. And we see now a lot of these NMEICT mission projects, the role of private institutions is also phenomenal. So we need a policy that also encourages the involvement of private institutions. And secondly, to also concentrate on rural geographies. Again, when NMEICT started, the first policy note was the bandwidth would be given to institutions in metros.
Mm.
So I said if an initiative of this type has to happen, it should be the other way. You have to start from rural because that's where the access is difficult. In metros anyway, you have a good number of faculty access available. So a rural crisis must be addressed. So as a policy, we need to you know, make sure that there is encouragement from private institutions and also that we don't leave out the rural geography from the picture. Make sure that there is some, you know, target that we also ensure that the access part is addressed. And thirdly, branding of NPTEL, NMEICT, we need to increase substantially. We've been hearing, you know, Coursera, we've been hearing edX, but NPTEL as a brand, you know, we need to really push it.
So, let me.
I think in current scenario, the use of technology in higher education is in its early stage.
Right.
So, use of these online resources and technology should be at the elective manner. Means, in regular curricula, there are two types of courses: regular core courses and other one is elective courses. So, what we can do? Initially, these courses should be put in that category, elective one.
Why is that?
So that if anybody, any university or any student wants to have that knowledge and that platform, he can use that.
No, why not? What's wrong with putting them in the core?
Initially, sir, in most of the universities, faculties and administrators are reluctant to these technologies.
No, if they are reluctant, then they won't use it, right? But why have anything in a policy that says they should be for elective and not for core? I don't see the reason for
that. I want to say that most of the time, if they are in elective, then initially they can have okay, that is in elective phase, or then they can have that.
I think he had his hand and then.
Yes,
and
I mean,
Professor Srinivas from Bombay University, principal of KU College of Engineering. So I would like to talk about the applicability of our all materials, NPTEL and etc. See the state university scenario now, and all the state universities have a non-uniform curriculum.
Right.
Then second is every 4 years we are changing the curriculum.
Sure.
Say for example, we give the NPTEL post-development etc. everything to IITs, but we don't have the similar type of the curriculum what IIT is offering. And moreover, therefore, what we decided, what is my suggestion is, a customization may be allowed at the state university, particularly for this NPTEL, whatever material you have. Or maybe state universities may be involved.
Sorry?
State universities may be allowed to involve in the content development.
Mm-hmm.
And moreover, if you see that, if you take any two universities in Andhra Pradesh and everywhere, there is a uniform curriculum. And second is, once you are giving the customization power, or maybe customization at university level, and certification and assessment will be given to the university itself. Need not to go for third part. Because as we are conducting the examinations for the all these affiliated colleges and constituent colleges, whatever norms we are there, we can pass on to the university authority. Probably they can execute that. Need not to go for third party evaluation, third party assessments. And that is the one. And second point is, whatever NPTEL you develop, you cannot use that. For example, say if any student, typically if you can take, any student joins the state university, always he looks for the curriculum. As the curriculum only is preparing for the examinations. And NPTEL sometimes, sometimes above the curriculum or maybe may not be matching the exact requirement of the university. So therefore, henceforth or maybe we have to give the recommendation stating that customization will be allowed or maybe at the university level, all the power will be given to the university for the executing and assessment, etc., whatever.
Right.
Then only you could see the success in the state universities.
Yeah.
And second important point is, what is the PhDs and M.Tech, that's the 12th program.
Can I ask you, just so that everybody else has a chance to make their comments, can we come back to the third statement so that some other...
Yes.
There was some talk of, I don't know whether it's really under the policy issue or not. My name is Dr. C.S. Arora. I work with NMICT. When the gentleman said that the policy should be for picking up the elective subjects first, I disagree, I gave the contra opinion. Because it is the core courses or the compulsory courses which comprise, which benefit the masses. Electives are taken by a few people. For example, I am a management student, for example. The first year courses which I had were all core courses. So everybody took that. So perhaps if you have to give a sort of preference if at all we have to give, so it should be for the compulsory in core courses. And then electives are taken by 10%, 12%, 7%, depending on the specialization, etc. So I just wanted to give a contra opinion. But I wonder whether this is a subject in this group to be discussed.
I mean, it is certainly about policy. So,
I think I have to say it on two areas, one on assessment and certification. I think very important thing in assessment is to look at the question that has been raised here. Is it, do you need to give a certain kind of percentage to be allowed to be earn credit through online learning, through assessment of online learning? I think this is very important, particularly regulatory agencies are putting restrictions. The AICT today talks about blended learning and puts at 15%. I think that's what something that we need to look at and see that, okay, this is at this moment, not for long, but at this moment we look at that kind of allowing that kind of an online learning provision.
You want to support that, right?
Yeah, to start with. otherwise it will be an anarchic situation to look at. So to start with. Number two is that on assessment part, I think it is important for any ICT projects and others who are developing online programs and MOOCs and other things to look at the open badges infrastructure framework. I think it's important that assessment is also made in open, and this the certification that people earn are available online for others to verify and check. I think that is something that should be looked at on an assessment. But I have more to say on rights related to content and technology. And especially, I work for the Commonwealth of Learning.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to wait because I'm just going to make sure. Yeah.
I'm Professor R.S. Kale from Thapa University. Regarding assessment and certification, I would like to say that we are having different universities, different type of colleges, and that are doing various core courses and various elective courses. And to come with the common, that is a syllabus or assessment technique, it's not possible. Okay, so what I think that we should make use of ICT techniques. Okay, like we should encourage NPTEL courses, and we should have these, assessment that is based upon these particular courses, and it should be open to all the students, whosoever is studying anywhere, okay, to be examined under these assessment exams, and the certification for those particular things should be done by MHRD or any of the IITs for that particular course. I think if we cultivate this particular habit, okay, so every student will be applying for more and more courses, certifications, and in this particular way, that is one. Even a student who is studying in a rural area or some say lower grade college can enhance his skill by coming to that particular level.
Yeah, this is similar. I mean, I think. I think somewhat reminds me of what Professor Kicha said, which is I think one of the benefits of the power of technology is that, in fact, you know, students may be able to be assessed against things that are not specific to where they study.
Yeah.
In other words, the process of learning and the process of assessment can be somewhat decoupled, but there needs to be a viable way for that to be recognized,
yeah,
so that the students can actually get credit for it. I don't know, I mean, I don't really know if it's a good or easy or hard or good or bad, but it's an interesting topic to discuss.
My name is Professor B.S. Pavla. I'm from NIT Pradhyam, Chandigarh.
Yeah.
On assessment and certification, we need to do assessment and certification. It is not that we offer the program and leave it. We don't certify it. I'll suggest that it should be technology-based testing only, because you can do, for a whole lot of students, you can do it at one go. The only fear I have is when you want to connect to the rural areas, when you want to connect the test, there will be no power there. Second is because universities have some variations in the curriculum,
yeah,
the coverage should be broad-based,
right,
from IITs or whosoever is doing it. But the universities may be able, allowed to select from the question bank depending upon their curriculum. They can select the question,
right,
and put it to their students there.
So let me,
myself, Professor Ardhan from Nectar. In assessment and certification, my viewpoint is already the products of NMICT is available. So it need to be certified by a third party, it's my suggestion, or a virtual university or some Nectar. So that certification need to be taken as a credit for other universities which are already available.
Mm.
Because for example, if there are any XY universities which are there, these credit points need to be taken care when they're awarding a degree.
Right, this is similar to what he was saying. So I think I got two, sort of points out of it that's worth discussing. One is whether we want to go to a situation where we allow assessments to be sufficiently decoupled with the certifying university, you know, as some means of recognizing it. That was one comment. And the second one goes back to the comment that was made in the document that we received, which is, do we want some some percentage of the credits to be done through online courses? Is it a good thing to have a number, and if so, what is the number? So the two questions that I feel like we need to discuss a bit more.
I think assessment and certification is at the heart of online
learning. Right.
And globally, people are still struggling. What is the best way of going about it? And therefore, in this group, perhaps, a recommendation of sorts that there should be a standing committee of under the NMICT, which looks at these issues on a continuing basis. UGC, for instance, has come out with some guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
And I was talking to vice chancellor of PTU who says that we have allowed 20% of our courses to be obtained through online methods, and we are going ahead with that. But you know, those kind of decisions, if taken hastily,
right,
I think can be quite, you know, rather than helping online learning and improving quality, they can be detrimental to their own.
So
maybe,
I
think on a continuing basis, number one. Number two, let us be very clear what we are talking about. You know, the focus here is mainstreaming technology uses to improve quality and expand student choice.
Right.
Improve quality is primarily how we can use technology to improve the quality of foundation courses or core courses, because they are the core where basic concepts are made, and particularly when we do not have quality faculty or no faculty available, then you know, making those core courses available of reasonably high quality becomes essential so that people have strong foundations. So there is, I think, how much of that can be used in a blended mode or online mode is something that has to be seen as we go along.
So, you know,
electives is about expanding student choice.
Sure.
I think beyond a few institutions, very few of our universities offer a bouquet of electives. And I think it is by aggregating demand across institutions, you know, that we can perhaps offer more electives. For instance, ICER, Trivandrum, ICER, Pune, and one other ICER, they are offering courses at the postgraduate level in quantum computing. And there are 50 students across these three ICERs. In each institution, there are only 10-15 students. So it is suboptimal for a professor to spend so much of time and energy. But there, it is not online courses. It is rather than face-to-face, they use video mediated code, you know, offering, and there is an understanding across institutions. And I think for electives, you know, similar kinds of institutions coming together and creating an aggregate of a student demand for particular courses for electives, so that we can have more choices in electives, would be a way forward. For online courses, how do we deal with giving certificate or giving, you know, assess NPTEL courses, which students may have there at their own time, asynchronously, or MOOCs courses is something which has to be really thought through very carefully, because you know, assessment would mean that after students claim that they have had gone through a particular online course, either MOOCs or NPTEL course, you are basically assessing them. You are taking an examination, and then giving them credits against that. So how much should we do it, and how far? You know, I think we are not very clear on that. And
so I think I want to actually move away from this topic because we have quite a few more to cover. What I think I'd do is I would summarize, saying that there are a bunch of issues that have to be that have to be discussed and decisions have to be taken. For instance, which kind of courses, core, and what's the what's the percentage of courses we expect to be done this way? Assessment methods, do we want to have broad and open assessments that people can leverage and use so that, and I think what other things that have come, so what I'll suggest is in the report, I'd simply say, I think our thinking is that these are all issues that need to be identified and discussed. So we propose, that MHRD has a standing committee continuously evaluates and makes appropriate quality policy divisions and reviews them periodically as well, rather than come up with a particular recommendation. I think that's probably the best way.
Professor Kincha is here, I think you would like to reflect on this.
Standing
Very sorry for interruption. I'll just take a 1 minute of yours. After this, you're supposed to go to hotel residence for 7 o'clock at conference dinner. So buses are available, sir.
Okay.
Anyone can avail car facility, can you know who wants
hotel residence?
Or residence?
Hotel residence. All of them are available. How far wants to avail the car facility? How far is it? It's hardly 3.5 kilometers. It's half an hour distance.
Other bus facility?
Buses are there.
What time it will leave?
6 o'clock.
Six to three. Let's make it 6 to 3.
Any car facility?
Okay. I think I want to, just in the interest of time, looking at the time and I forgot what it was.
Particularly, this is very important, Professor, that non-uniform curriculum.
Sorry?
Very important. Non-uniform curriculum for the universities. That we have to, emphasize. Because we are getting all NPTEL, but our students are not following. They are only looking only for the what the curriculum, what it is.
I'm actually relying on the rapporteur to taking a notes later to summarize. So don't worry, otherwise it'll take too much time now. But let's move on to some of the other topic because it's 5:16. What time are we supposed to close? Yeah, we have only like 1 hour and we've only covered one topic. So another thing that I culled out of these discussions is that. Do we want, MHRD to have policies or recommendations regarding what technology should be used or in any way, I mean, not specific technology, but whatever we want to say about it, or standards for technology and platforms and so on, or do we want to simply, let it evolve, through the process of market right now and maybe too premature? I don't know. Any opinions on this? Yeah.
I have a password somewhere.
My name is Venkatesh Shankar and I used to be earlier operator and director for ITAC and I now am with a non-profit called Knowledge Conference. We are studying the syllabus of different courses and one of the challenges we see is that it mentions specific brand names. And in some ways it's like saying that you don't teach driving but you teach moral. So the problem is that if the brand name is embedded in the syllabus then the teacher and the students do not have the choice of which tool to use. And I want to segue from that to the next topic, which is open source. And one of the advantages with open source is that when as a teacher I'm teaching a particular skill, I can also share the software along with that.
Sure.
And in places like Kerala where the teachers are using open source software to teach children, they are finding that the ability to share the software is also helping the kids learn when they go back to the home. And there's a kind of consistency in the tools that they are using. So my thesis is that I've argued and fought with a bunch of syllabus institutions saying that the syllabus should specify principles and not products.
I mean, I have to question that. What is it doesn't mean that everybody has to, all the universities and colleges have to follow that. What if a particular college decides that they want to teach that particular skill? Why is that a problem?
So,
why I'm saying it is at the end of the day, right, when the student gets certified and assessed, they may be lacking in something if the university limits itself to one type of platform or technology. So, I don't know if there is a reason that you're saying that.
So, I would say, what you're saying is that the education system must teach principles and not products. And another thing would be that it should teach word processing and not a specific product.
Okay, so this is applying to things. This is about, I guess.
But which product the university or the institution chooses is, that's up to their choice.
Yeah, so I get it. It's kind of content, right? Specify concepts and topics, right?
Yes.
Not products.
No, another danger of specifying a particular product is that if the product gets outdated, the syllabus doesn't change so often.
Right.
So the syllabus might be specifying a product which is fairly outdated.
Right. So I'm actually not that familiar with this process, right? I'm thinking, the university would realize that their students are no longer learning the right thing. Is that not the case?
No.
This could even if you don't specify it could happen, right? That they teach a particular product. See, you don't have to specify to the syllabus.
Yes, but
you can't actually control exactly what the teacher teaches in the classroom.
Yes.
They may use a particular product to train the concepts.
Yes.
So I don't know how far.
The challenge is that if it is hard-coded in the syllabus, then neither the teachers nor the students.
Yeah. So that makes sense, I think, not to hard-code the syllabus. Okay.
Actually, if you see in the state university, policies, syllabus should be framed by the state university. Cannot be given to the NMI. So technology, yes, is required. Because the problem is, government is insisting to all the universities should have.
No, that's fine. But he was making a broad statement
yes.
about Syllabus can still be set by the state university.
Yes.
But he was making a broad statement that the syllabus, no matter how it is set, should not have specific products because that ultimately limits the...
That's what I have one line to add. Actually, what happens? No, all the government is insisting for all institutes to have the NAC accreditation or maybe NBA. Accreditation. As far as accreditation is concerned, every university should have the NAC accreditation, NAC A grade, or NBA. Now NBA is moving to Abbott, Washington DC. So the moment we are talking about Washington DC and NBA, always we should have the technology enabled education.
Okay.
Technology standards are always required. And particularly if you see what are the practical problems we are facing, you are recommending the technology and etc., policies, etc. For implementing the state university, they don't have the funding. For example, say you are asking to
I'm not sure where you're going with this.
That's what I'm just. Therefore, we need the technology standards for the achieving the accreditations.
There's a difference between standards in terms of the kind of functionalities or whatever the technology or product is capable of versus having a specific named product. That's what I think.
For example, say web-based learning or e-content, e-delivery, etc. For implementing for the college, they need at least some funding is required. If it's a particularly government colleges, they don't have specific funding for the implementing this type of technologies. Therefore, what is my request is maybe a recommendation. Whenever NMEICT recommending the technology and policies, they can also recommend the government for the funding for implementing of that.
Unless you want to respond.
I think the point that he's made is very good, that the focus should be on concepts rather than specific.
That makes sense.
But there is a trade-off here. And the trade-off is that, industry wants the graduate should be useful from day one.
Sure.
And unless they are well-versed in a particular product which industry is using, they feel that they know the concepts, but they are not useful to them. So how do we create a trade-off between that?
Right. I thought what you were saying is there's a difference between allowing the institution or the university to teach specific products because that's what the industry wants versus coding it in syllabus as a requirement.
I
thought not coding it in syllabus left things open, but as university which wants to make sure its students are employable will teach the things that the industry wants. Is that naive view?
Then industry feels that the graduates are not employed.
Right, so the university will
have to work through a specific product, orientation in a specific product.
No, I don't mean that. If the university doesn't teach the particular product, those students wouldn't be employed. So the university would be smart enough to teach it, even though it isn't.
Precisely, yeah.
It won't be coded in the syllabus as that product. But when it comes to teaching that subject, they would go ahead and teach that because they don't. So is that a naive view is what I'm saying? Yeah, I think he has been wanting to
say. That's a fair point. My name is Girish, by the way. I run a small startup in Pune. But my past life, I was the director of ICT for State Government of Victoria, Department of Education. That's a very interesting topic because employability and skill development unfortunately relates to some of the products we use. And what we find in India is people finishing their BEs and then going to a CDAT course to get skilled in a particular technological industry. I think here's where policy...
What's an example?
So say you do a CDAT in course in Java technologies, or say in .NET, or say in Oracle databases or Citus. So you go and do this specific course to kind of get skilled for the industry. Shouldn't we, from a policy perspective, kind of make some leeway or provide guidelines on what the common skill requirements of the industry is and make sure
that will change over time, wouldn't it?
Sorry?
What the industry needs as a common benchmark would evolve over time anyway.
But shouldn't that curriculum be evolving from a policy perspective as well? Because we are still, like I did my master's, and I did the same data management system subject, which was 5 years ago,
right.
Was exactly, except for additional few other things.
Right.
But the market has moved on with their products, and I find myself totally unemployable with the skills or knowledge that I have. So shouldn't, from a policy perspective, we should get closer to what the
if we try to do that, right? In other words, if we try to regulate too much, then we'll spend a lot of effort by people who are not actually the players in the game, neither the students, nor the teachers, nor the employers, a bunch of people who write policy, we constantly writing policy that changes over time. Instead, what I'm thinking is, it's in the best interests of the institution to teach the thing that industry needs right now. And if they don't do so, well, they'll be out of, is that a naive view?
Different companies have different requirements.
That too.
There are institutions like Microsoft, there will be a division of Microsoft which is looking for people of the A kind.
Right.
There will be a division of Microsoft which is looking for a totally different kind of people. Which is to say that there will be certain institutions that will cater to people required by this sector of the industry. And there will be institutions that will say, wait a minute, I don't want to serve that industry, I want to serve this other industry. So each institution has to decide for himself and for itself as to which is that sector in the industry that it wants to cater to. I mean, as an example, I mean, a large number of our engineering colleges should cater to or could cater to the immediate needs of the industry. But at the same time, there should be many institutions that should be looking way beyond that. They should be producing the leaders of tomorrow, not of yesterday. And I think that is the philosophy that the IITs are following.
I think it's a very philosophical question. Is the university supposed to teach a concept like, for example, database, which you know, a student will kind of retain for the rest of his life? Or is it supposed to teach a concept?
I think, look, in my opinion, university can teach whatever they want. Okay, I mean, there is no should. I think the more they teach, the more the student knows, right? But there are certain basics we expect them to teach, otherwise the student wouldn't be learned in the subject. But there's nothing that prevents the university from having a Java course or a .NET course or whatever. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it. We are just not requiring in this basic syllabus that they teach a specific product. Sorry, sir, I think he had...
I just want to tell that we're talking about use of technology in higher education.
Right.
I think if we keep on debating about...
Yeah, you're right.
This will be an endless debate and we will not go anywhere.
I think the high level point was made. I think if it's the same topic, let's move on. I think we have said enough about it.
I think on the technology point, actually we didn't miss that. What is that?
Right.
We are looking at what technology should be used and recommended.
So there are two. Okay, here is how I separate. You know, even though you may be teaching, .NET, in the context of this discussion, that's content.
Yeah, that's content. That's it.
What the topic here was, okay, about content we said that there should be no specific recommendation. But there is still a question about technology that is used for online learning.
Yes.
Do we want to have any standards? I think it's quite premature to have anything more than standards because there aren't enough products out there to really make any recommendation anyway. But what do we want to have anything in the policy about what technology is used and how it's used and anything like that?
So I think there are standards.
Okay.
Yeah, there are standards available on learning technology standards.
Okay.
That's one thing that we'll look at.
Okay.
The second thing that we'll look at, when the courses are getting developed, any institution that develops courses should adopt standard industry practices, like metadata standards are there. If you are developed a course, you should follow certain metadata
standards. What's an example of a standard here?
Dublin Core is a metadata standard that's used for specifying metadata, which is widely used.
No, in the context of this, what is
it? Yeah, for the developing courses. This will be related to courses that are being developed in Indian institutions.
So what is an example of?
Just an example like a course on NMEICT course on ePaathshala or anything that is got developed on NPTEL. How that course is structured. So learning technology standards are missing. So we must have appropriate learning technology standards which is adopted worldwide. Courses are delivered through strong standards. Learning technology standards, strong standards. And of course metadata standards. There are standards available. The courses need to follow, we may not specify the standards, but we have to say that any courses, institutions in the, that are developing, engineering institutions or universities that are developing, should follow established industry standards for learning, designing, discovery of the courses, etc.
One second, sir. I
think there are two questions to be answered. I think one is a very controversial question. Many of you raised it. Common is there. I And I'm going to ask this question. Is it a ruling or is it a policy statement by government that anything which is developed by government funds, using government funds, has to be an open source? Or can it be something else also? This is one question that I need the answer to. This is a perception everywhere, wherever meeting, whichever we go, government funded projects or government funded activities, it is assumed that whatever we develop has to be open source. Is it a policy directive by government or not? Is a question that I need to answer. This is one thing. So that will open up a lot of questions of what is open source versus what you may call as business. What you may call as business. Now, if you see the industry, or if you see the real world as a whole, and if you see the percentage of use of whatever software, whatever application, whatever we do, I think the use of open source software still in this time's world is less than 20%. The world actually uses the other type of software. Now, therefore this question will come of whatever is developed by government funded agencies, what type of standards they have to stick to. I give one classic example. CDAC and MCIT spent crores of rupees and thousands of man hours developing an equivalent of office software. Office software. I spent a time to learn about that. Now it is 6 years, 7 years, I think that is the time frame. Except a few government officers, nobody uses that software. Nobody uses that software. So this is a very philosophical and very, or say, a policy decision. Is it just getting limited to the open source, or can it be something else also? So if that answer comes, then I'll have something more.
Can I respond to this?
Yes.
I think though explicitly there will not be any government notification that whatever is government funded will be in open source, but I think by default, that is an assumption.
Everywhere you go, this is
happening. This is an assumption, and I think as the developments in other nations are, I think they have issued, they have laws, at least in America, you know, that whatever research is done in the public, with the public funds, is to be shared. Is to be shared. I think US has
that. Has that. But it's
so
in India also.
So
research sharing is.
So I think there has to be a more a better articulation, articulation of what could be an appropriate stand of the government on this particular issue.
Okay,
no, I don't know what it should be,
so,
but
so
I think a better
articulation. Let me, Professor Jain had his hand in that. Okay.
So I think in large way, it is not about educational content. Let's just talk about intellectual content.
Okay.
DST has always maintained that any intellectual property developed by an education institution, whether it is privately funded or government funded, if the project is funded by DST, that intellectual property shall belong to the institution. DST does not wish to own the intellectual property. DIT, on the other hand, maintained that. And I think. So DIT had maintained that all intellectual property so developed under a project funded by DIT would be the property of DIT, except that in the last few months they have changed this
policy.
And now such intellectual property belongs to the institution that has developed this, even if the project was funded by DIT or DBT or whatever it is.
Right, so what I was going to say, right, the problem with this has come up everywhere, which is, at least in the US, on the one hand, universities are trying to maintain rights to the things they develop, because then they can patent it and then they can commercialize it. And many of the things that they develop is done through NSF funding or other types of funding, right? So on the one hand, you know, there is an interest in encouraging universities to be a bit more entrepreneurial. On the other hand, there is a feeling that taxpayers have already paid for the development. Do they have to? I'm not sure that this is the place with respect to policies on online education where we should have that kind of a decision. Because it's, as I think Professor Jain said, it's much broader than online education, first of all.
We have, because in the next slide you have put rights.
That's why I put it. So
the
what
right I think is an issue already.
No. What I'm saying is the reason I put it is because one of the points in the note that was sent to us had this. The question was, education technology that is developed, so AVU or something, for example, under the funding of NMEICT or other government organizations, should they be open source? Which is a different question from should they be whatever, but they should be. Yeah, the ownership is not to them, and it's for, I think these are good questions, but my only question is, Isn't this superseded by a broader level?
I think in this context. While I would like to make a distinction between intellectual property assets in general,
right,
and what are being developed in the NMICT,
right,
what possibly can happen is that by default they should be in open source, but if some developer feels that there is an opportunity of commercializing it,
right,
he should put together a proposal within a certain time period and commercialize it. Because even if it is commercialized, then I think more people have, we will use it. But to basically allow them to patent it and not allow it to be used by others would mean that that innovation or that work gets lost.
I'm actually making a different distinction, okay? Yeah. I mean, maybe this is too fine, but one of them is, there's a difference between it being in the public domain, which means that the particular organization that developed it cannot commercialize it, so everybody should be able to use it. And you can also have things like it may be given license, the free license for certain type of usage, non-commercial usage, right? These are all standard intellectual property type of choices, but that's not the same as open source. Open source actually is a little bit more specific in the sense that it opens the source completely as opposed to the end product and allows you to innovate on top of that. There's a huge difference between requiring that something be in public domain, but the source is not necessarily open. I mean, it's not, versus requiring that it be open source. Those are not the same thing. And I don't think we should confuse that. That's why I put it as two different. One is rights related to content and technology, and the other is open source. They're not the same. And I think we want to make sure we don't confuse the two.
One of the important distinctions we need to make is what is in the larger public interest. And I'll give an example of some of the technologies developed by government for Indian language, not Bombay. So there are a lot of technologies which the government is spending enormous amount of money on developing these technologies. But how many people are using Indian language technologies out there? So I think the government's funding would be best leveraged in terms of larger public interest if those technologies were under an open source license, which even allowed for commercial use.
This is a general debate, about whether that is the right way, or in fact allowing people to have proprietary software that they can own. I mean, it's not immediately obvious to me, especially coming from Microsoft.
So I think my argument is that it is in
the larger public interest to make things open source. I mean, that is one position, but I wouldn't say, therefore, in the
naturally. It seems to be open source or nothing. It's going to be shareware or freeware, which the property rights hold.
There are two different issues. Okay. One is whether property that is developed under government funding should be shareware or freeware, which generally seems like a good idea, frankly, because it's developed. But even that, I think, I'm not sure is unique to this particular topic.
I just have one thing. I can't get the hang of the discussion that we're going to do. But I think the issue is we're not talking about outcomes at all. Now, I've been in multiple listings where CDAP has developed so many things, DST has developed so many things, language-based and other things. Where is it today? I mean, is it out in the market or not is the question. It could be open source, it's available for public and everything, but what's the outcome of those things is one thing. On the other hand, there are public-private partnerships which have essentially thrown open a whole bunch of things, maybe at a cost, but it actually has the potential to actually take it out in there, and it has an incentive to go and multiply itself into a certain level of outcomes. And I think, as far as from a not much of a policy person, but I think if there was something that was looking at technology and usage in this thing, I don't think the government or whatever should say this technology is better than that technology,
so,
or
so I'll give concrete examples from this.
I think, you know, let's not even bother too much about what is written there.
Just as I'm illustrating.
The point I think he's making is very important.
Right.
Since by default it goes that everything that is developed with public funding should be an open source, but in the larger public interest, it may not be the best way of going forward.
Right.
I think if in some areas there are commercial incentives associated with larger use of that intellectual property, there may be benefits in that.
Right.
And there may be, you know, so then there are interests which will ensure that it is used by more people.
I think that's what I'm saying, right? Rights related to content and technology developed under government funding, making this shareware or freeware, that seems fairly...
As long as we include things like inclusion, coverage, reach, and other things, that the technology, it cannot be that I get government funding to target a certain audience, which otherwise could be targeted through a commercial, this thing, and I...
One of them is saying that if I get some government funding and I develop some technology, then I'm obligated to give it free to other people in the community to use. That seems like a very innocuous sort of statement, right? That's all I'm saying. The other is, right, that we require the institutions only to use technology that is open source or that is in public domain. And that seems like a rather severe restriction, and I'm not sure we want to make that.
So that is the thing, saying whichever is the position that is taken, or it's a combination or a hybrid position, the position has to reflect itself in that reach that it can get. Because at the end of the day, the government is going to fund, either it's a grant or it's a soft loan or whatever, subsidized loan, whatever this thing is, that money is actually given for you to actually get that reach, which is not happening. Otherwise, you're not getting that commercial capital to build something. I think that's that part, the position of inclusion, be it with people rural or disabilities or tier 2, tier 3 colleges or courses which are not touched upon in sectors, say plastic, ceramics and other things. I think what I'm saying is the policy should be a little more deeper in terms of the usage of the technology and the outcomes that come out of it, rather than what technology, how it goes in. So I think, because we have all of that, but it's just hasn't taken off, so that's the issue, I think.
Professor Kitcha,
and
then... Yeah, you see, if you take this particular context, there are two types of development. One are the content-related development. A faculty develops a content. The condition is it has to come onto the subject portal. Once it comes on the subject portal, the faculty loses the copyright of that. Copyright of that comes to the subject folder. So there, the faculty has done that work, he got that money and cash. The other type of activities is the technology and the platform development. I took two specific examples. One, you mentioned the AVU technology. The other can be, let us say, the FOSS lab, equivalent of MATLAB. Now that is completely developed. Now if I see the market, MATLAB is a big business. Now if some person then develops FOSS lab by government technology, will it again become an open source technology in the market, or FOSS lab will become a commercially available product? These questions will come up. If IIT Bombay today develops FOSS lab, it belongs to IIT Bombay or does it belong to anyone? That is the question that we are
asking. That's a problem that
I something on this. I think lot of confusion happening on IPR, copyright, the open source. Actually, these are because of I think training needed on these issues. IPR is much broader in that sense. But look at the two things I will talk about, what you have been talked about. Using open source for doing certain tasks, whether the government of India should mandate or not. This is one thing, because this is one question. This is the Department of IT has done some recommendations on this, particular to e-gov. Click the same thing, look at technology developed with government funding, should it be available in open source or not? This is what we should look at. Because important thing is that if you develop a technology using what is happening elsewhere in this country in some of the projects, that government is giving money to develop certain projects, certain technologies, and nobody knows about that. That's one reason. Because you have not developed a community of practice around the technology to take forward. and then technology dies. Nobody knows about those things. Proprietary interest, it might work for some time, but it may not work for a longer time than certain products. So we need to clarify those issues. Important thing I want to emphasize in the context of enemy ICT and content generation, it's completely different. And another issue of copyright comes in. Any person who develops content retains copyright by virtue of developing that content. Even if you have developed it for Government of India, because Government of India has paid the money, the rights remains with Government of India, but you are the moral copyright holder of that. Moral right remains with you. So you can do anything on that material. But essentially, that's law says in this country. Essentially, you have the moral copyright, you can do anything with that content. But the rights of, then comes the issue of, as per copyright law, the licensing issues. And therefore, open licensing issues come into these issues. And open licensing, especially the Creative Commons type of licensing, are very important. I think we need to look at content created with the public funding should be available in open licenses.
So let me suggest this, okay, as a summary, right? Once again, I would be very uncomfortable that this, you know, small group like, you know, group like this makes policy decisions for people. But I think we have identified three topics, and I'd like to just highlight the three topics about which policies have to be made. Not make the policy itself. One of them is content that is developed using government funding, NME, ICD. The questions are, is that content freely available, freely available to everyone in the country, or, you know, government funded universities, or is it at the discretion of the person who developed the content to give it when, you know, how they want it, things like that. I think that is some decision that has to be statement that has to be made about it. Okay, I don't think we need to actually decide what it is, but it needs to be announced, right? So second is, let's say similarly, technology that is developed using government funding. There are two questions there. One is, should that technology once again be freely available so that this person cannot commercialize it, or should they be allowed to commercialize it, or some variation thereof? And the second question is, should that technology be required to be open source? That means,
so this question is
an answer.
This has been answered by DST, it has been answered by DBT, it has been answered
what's
by...
What's the answer?
The answer is, only the grounds of the DBT will develop, the DBT institution will
develop. Okay, so we don't have to. What about the open source?
It is for the institution to decide what it wants to do.
So there's no policy that it needs to be open
source?
So in terms of, you're saying currently there is no policy that says... Wait, sir, I just want to make sure we are understanding. In my, there's a clear difference between, non-commercial, meaning that it's given license free, in other words, free license to anybody, versus that it's open source, meaning that you're giving the source. I'm asking the second question, is there any policy that it, you know, there are things. Okay, then we'll leave it there. But the third question is now in terms of usage of technology, one of the questions that was raised. Technology that is used in the context of NMACD-supported online education programs, can they be proprietary technology, or do they have to be open source? So that's the question, right? So I'm saying we'll identify the three questions as three separate questions, right? And I would suggest, you know, this needs to be debated and decided.
I would delete question number two.
You would delete question number two. Okay.
I mean, let's not open the discussion. After having struggled with this question,
okay, then
for many years, we have tried to convince DIT this is the wrong policy of
okay.
Right? The DIT has finally conceded that the intellectual property will belong to the institution.
Okay.
It has worked.
Okay.
I think if
so what does
back to DIT?
I think some research to distinction has to be made between certain what Pavan told about products with commercial possibilities and products that are related to educational content. And intellectual property in the context of DST cannot be looked at products that are developed in education research. Worldwide, the public policy is now getting into, you know about the US policies and UK policies now. Worldwide, publicly funded educational research technology materials should be available in open licenses, so that generally everyone can make use of that. See, open source doesn't say you cannot commercialize. You can provide training and earn money out of that. You can provide services. So there is a lot of confusion about at a leadership level about these legal issues. It is important that public funded money, when the public is funding certain things, should be made available to the public to make broader use of that technology, that content, that
I'm going to summarize by saying, like, this topic was raised and there were considerably diverging opinions, and leave it at that because we are not going to converge on that. So let's move on. There was one question with respect to pushing. I think I read it out of one of the questions. There are a bunch of technology that we even learned about today, right, that was development under. Do we want to make any policy statements about the government actively pushing those technologies for further usage? Is that being done today, or do we want to say anything about it or not?
I think it is, but
we have to incentivize commercialization of what is already there.
Right.
If you just take whatever, if you take even agriculture, for example,
yeah,
all the machinery that's required to solve problems with small farmers is there, CEDAR, in PUSA, and every other institute being developed.
Yeah.
If you look at linguistics and other areas where machine translation, CDAG and other people have done it, what doesn't happen is, because they want to put it on open source, nobody wants to come and commercialize it, nobody wants to monetize it. Now open it up, throw it out for public-private partnerships, and put in SLAs which are leading to outcomes and reach. And I think that is a, and if the government wants to, is giving away a grant or a subsidized loan to a commercial entity or an academic entity which is going to profit from it at some point, at least ensure that you're getting something back for the public in terms of the larger school and not exactly money.
No. So let me read the specific comment that made me write this.
Okay. Is it a good idea to come up with policy measures or incentives to increase the use of NMEIC created content such as NPTEL, virtual labs and spoken tutorials and curricula? Or should these projects try to improve their work so as to increase their acceptance?
That you know, when you ask a question like that, it sounds like that after they should improve their work.
Second part is more important.
No, but is there anything we want to, I think what you're saying is incentivize.
For commercialization.
Commercialization and improvement to the level of commercialized product.
It doesn't matter if it's open source philosophy or if the closed source philosophy, whoever comes in, if they can do the job better.
No, this is nothing with open source. It's simply
whoever comes in, I think can come and do the job better. The government should just allow them to commercialize it.
It is a corollary. If you make the materials in the content developed in NPTEL, in CCGY SA, anyone can commercialize and sell. If somebody else is commercializing and selling the product, and if you are not able to reach to that place, there is nothing wrong. So once you make open licensing something like CCBY-SA, it automatically makes commercialization possibility of your product.
Just that you cannot distort the market where somebody comes in and invests money to build something and you get something free from the government. And you saying the larger interest of good, I need everything for free. I don't think that's
acceptable. You take a bank loan, but you don't.
See, the things that are not specific to education, technology, or content, there's endless debate about public property, public investment, and things like that. Frankly, I don't think it makes sense. There's nothing specific to education technology here. That's not true of other technologies, right? Even for that matter, DST.
Yeah.
I don't really think we need to be spending a lot of time at that level. The only question that was asked was NMEICT has invested a fair amount in developing certain technologies, and do we want to push it out? I think the answer I got was it's a good idea to incentivize to get them out, but not make policies that say people should necessarily use them. They're not good products, people shouldn't use them.
But we should also realize that this morning, Professor Pathak was saying it's a problem of scale. Right. Mr. Jain was right that every institution must try to nurture leaders for tomorrow.
Right.
But then if every institution starts doing that, we don't have enough leadership positions at all. So, but there are some institutions, and that's why I reiterate, there are some institutions which very badly need these outputs. And today we are at a stage to identify some NMEICT outputs which have met those standards, and some, unifying courseware that is broadly across the spectrum of all type of institutions. Let's say as a pilot, we want to experiment this with tier 2, tier 3 institutions. There are definitely a portfolio of courses and definitely some tangible outputs from the mission project. And
I don't find any reason to say, you know, you better use this on it because it's in the larger interest, because it's a problem of scale. And students, I repeatedly say this, you know, this is a good substitute for a bad faculty or for a no faculty. And definitely, you know, this incentive, it may not be a monetary incentive, it could be an academic incentive, actually. You use this, and definitely there are a bigger set of stakeholders.
No, I think there's a different issue, right? I think, see, when does this question become relevant? It becomes relevant when somebody needs something, and technology is not available, except through the NME, ICT, which is very specialized. Now, at that point, it makes every sense for, you know, that to be evangelized and people to use it. But I'm not sure, you know, if there is something that is available, that, you know, there's no reason why this small university would not be able to use it. I don't quite see the logic here.
No, it is available, but what is the push to use it? Today, even the courses are available. Now, why is that then nobody is using it?
I understand. When you say push, right, there is, so you know, the gentleman said incentivizing, you know, people to use it because, you know, they can be taken to a larger scale. It makes sense. But, you know, when you say push, what do you really mean?
No, I mean, I'm just putting it in the most diplomatic way, but you can mandate it saying that, you know, there are some, see, it's not a big challenge to identify a common denominator that links certain set of courses with certain major disciplines. It's not a big challenge. And we know that there are some institutions which desperately need this. Let's say this is the course and this is the material that needs to be followed. And why is all this, the 10,000 teacher training program, I mean, they are the facilitators to roll out the NMEICT output. They don't become masters.
There's a difference between evangelizing something, right, and mandating it. They're not the same.
No, but we can embed it carefully into the curriculum as how are you prescribing textbooks?
So what I'm saying is it makes sense to say NMEICT, you know, should actively evangelize and promote the products that are developed under its funding, so that, you know, many institutions use it. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
But that doesn't use the word mandate.
But does, in your syllabus, okay, let's say the syllabus is a mandate of the university that the affiliated colleges has to follow this.
But writing the syllabus is not the responsibility.
No, I'm not saying you have to write the syllabus.
It's not the responsibility of the majority of the academic companies. It is the sole responsibility and the prerogative the university senate.
Precisely. I'm not altering the DNA of the university. A syllabus can be done. That's why I'm saying there are a set of courses that serve as an academic on denominator. Tell me, you know, are you telling me that in every university for a certain set course they are all unique in their own way?
No. There is a difference between leveraging what is available as a common pool and being mandated to do so. They're not the same. I think it's the word mandate that I don't want to use because that suggests that we are sort of forcing people to do something. But evangelizing it actively, pushing it out, making it visible, promoting it, all those things, all those words make sense.
But then a policy directive is almost a mandate.
It's not a mandate. Policy is
just a mandate. You can create a supportive ecosystem that encourages the use of it.
Right.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay, so we're almost out of time. Are there any other topics? Windows, this general category, professor.
So there is an issue that I'd like to bring out. I don't know if it's out there.
Yeah.
The government policies, so government has been making policies for different policies for different sets of institutions.
Okay.
And I think that is perhaps not the right thing.
Yeah,
in respect of distance education,
right.
And I guess the use of MOOC and all that.
Use of?
The use of MOOCs and
okay.
So forth, largely all in the basket of distance education.
Okay.
At least if you get some form of distance education.
I see.
Yeah. So the government has different policies applied to government funded universities, privately funded universities, state universities versus centrally funded universities. So-called institutions of national importance and institutions not of national importance. Is there a trend that must be arrested? Particularly in respect to distance education. The government has mandated that distance education shall not be undertaken by a class of universities.
It has.
It has.
Which class?
green universities.
Okay. Why is that?
I think we should ask the...
See, the problem there was because of... See, there are good, you know, there are bad public universities and bad private universities. So because of certain bad private universities, the 2010 regulations, as you rightly pointed out, has put a stop to
We are saying that there are no bad state-funded universities.
That's what I said. There are bad public universities. There are bad public universities, and
but
there are
does not
no, don't say like that.
There are some. I said.
Yeah, don't comment. Why do
I said there are some.
Openly, don't comment. Bad. Why do you want to use that bad word?
I openly said there are bad public universities and bad private universities. Both. No, what's wrong? I mean, I said both public and private. I am not saying
both. The general way of this. That's what.
No, the genesis of this regulation we wanted to know. That's why.
About something is very specific. No, I think yeah. I mean, it makes sense. But I don't see why the government should make different policies for different.
And this is what I raised before. I mean, the role of private
institutions. Deemed universities were created for a particular purpose. They were created for specific subject-oriented, discipline-oriented things. Suddenly, at some places, it became a general university.
Yes.
And then distance education started.
Yes.
Okay. And there are history behind the why these universities were stopped.
There is
a history in that.
Is there a justification?
There is a history.
Is there a justification?
But that history
is there a justification?
Government had an issue to demand.
Okay.
Did you know that?
So let's move away. No, I think we got the point of
just one. Whatever the policy or technology is, it can't just be, because it comes in the last topic on assessment and certifications. It just cannot be that. It should cover the entire value chain of activities that make up education.
Example,
I can speak of skill development, for example. The way we look at innovations or funding innovations is we start from the learner at the source. What is the problem? The learner, aspirations, awareness, counseling, career counseling, and then adoption, sitting through the course, not dropping out, learning methodologies which are used in the classroom or blended, flipped, whatever it is. Outcomes are measured through an assessment. So whatever the technology is, should kind of encompass all these different elements which make education. It should not just come at either the learning level, or it should not just come at the assessment level, or at the certification level. It should be a fairly integrated process if somebody is taking it up. So,
I'm just confused. I mean, you can wish that, but how can you dictate it by policy?
No, you cannot dictate it. I'm just saying, see, if the policy, the larger guideline that is going to be issued is, okay, here is something that you can take up. Okay, this NME, ICT, this is the whole thing. Now, there are two elements to it. Make it six elements that make up that whole thing. So you're actually creating a full hub or a center of excellence for that thing. So it can act as a fully fledged hub, which can move out to different, get out there. So it just doesn't look at training, doing one course in computer science, and then what is it really? What's the point of
this? No, I understand. See, as a thrust or as an initiative or as an activity or as a kind of thing to fund, NME, ICT, taking this broad view makes sense. But maybe the policy statement would be that NME, ICT would in fact invest in developing all aspects of the learning process and not limited to one or the other.
Let it be coherent and comprehensive in the sense. Don't develop content for some other subject,
right,
and build a learning module for something, and do a delivery platform for an audience which doesn't use either of these. If I look at the project,
I understand what you want, but I don't understand how to translate it into meaningful policy.
Right. So the only thing I can think of is if you set up an IIT, there is a policy that it has to have these ingredients. If you set up an IIM, these are going to be the ingredients. And here is a phased rollout on first year, second year, third year, and fifth year, and tenth year. Similarly, for an MEICT, there should be a life cycle analysis of where this project is going in terms of this thing. Where is it starting? Rather than saying, you just developed this for 2 years, it's over, now let's
push this. No, I understand. But I think, we shouldn't spend too much more time. I think there is a confusion between NME, ICT as a mission and what it does versus MHRD policies that we are trying to identify. The two are not the same.
No, it matters.
The mission.
Just so that we don't keep on going back and forth. What you said is very correct. NMEICT is a mission for a certain period of time.
Right.
And at the end of this mission will go. It creates something, doesn't create something. Whatever happens, happens and everything. But tomorrow, if you see the country scenario, there will be private players who will be coming into this field of online education. With private players, we may create a similar infrastructure. And maybe the Reliance group, they have a complete infrastructure available, or some other one. And they will also get content created. And they will do all the activities with the NMICT is doing in the public space. So it is not the sole body actually. So therefore the policy perspective that we are talking about has to reflect that reality also in the field. That there will be private players also coming to the field. But as a nation, we are interested in the education given to our public. And therefore, every policy has to take care of that particular requirement. Also, with NMICT only being one part of it. Tomorrow, there will be a number of private players that will be coming into this field. Another 5 years, you will see a lot of
applications. Okay, I want to wind down simply, you know, because of time. And I'm tired. I only wanted to add Professor Tinchar's observation. Yes, NMICT is for a limited period of time. But nevertheless, even though after NMICT ceases, the mission objectives, that is making the free e-conference reach in any time, anywhere mode without charging money to all the higher education students. So that without charging any money, but making it available free is the mission objective based on which 5 years, 7 years ago, and so, in that eventuality of private place coming and sort of charging students for achieving the same type of e-contents and all that, perhaps we'll be defeating the purpose to which NMICT has.
What I was telling Arunabh is that our objective, the NMICT objective is providing anywhere, anytime education
free
of cost. Tomorrow there will be private players who will provide the same thing but cost basis. So it will be again the same playing field of private universities versus common universities coming up to the field. And there will be a policy
question that I will put. Now, important high observation was the policy, when NMICT is in existence, when using NMICT in regulation, would have to be different than the policy after NMICT is in existence. So that is what I wanted.
So there, if there are no other comments, I think thank you very much for everyone. I have no idea how I'm going to summarize this.
You have a difficult task.